Spotlight is proudly sponsored by HEC Media.
All of us have experienced a situation where we've been stripped from something.
The minute you start making a prejudicial notion about a person, you know you're going to be making a mistake.
We give them the ability to hope.
Today on Spotlight, an update on the new one-dose nasal vaccine being developed at WashU. Plus, a bakery doing more than just making bread. They give hope. And then the intersection between art and the world's most pressing issues. But first, the latest from the St. Louis County Library. It's Sunday and you're watching the Emmy Award-winning Spotlight.
This month, the St. Louis County Library, HEC Media, and Left Bank Books brought together writing legend Walter Mosley, author of the iconic Easy Rawlins detective series, and suspense writer Rachel Howzell Hall for a one-on-one conversation to talk about his latest thriller, Blood Grove.
Could you please share what Blood Grove is about in your own words? Everyone's happy because Easy Rawlins is back.
It's always about the same thing, but that thing is always different. He starts in 1939 with Gone Fishing, which isn't a mystery, and then 1948 with Devil in a Blue Dress, which is a mystery. And then we slowly start coming up to time. It's like 15 books. So as all of Easy's books, there's transitions. Now we're in 1969. He's almost 50. He's aging. And racism, the notions of it are changing. His identity of who he is, it's very much about what veterans, you know, go through, people who've experienced war, and how they identify themselves, how they identify each other.
In America, everything is about either race or money or some combination of the two. Mm-hmm. And that, for me, carried through everything. And it kind of made me sad because that was a reality, you know, 60 years ago, 100 years ago, today. Is that what you carry with every book?
I'm being political because I'm always writing about Black male heroes specifically and Black people in general. But the books themselves might, you can be about all kinds of different things. Easy, on the other hand, he is always dealing with it because, like in this novel, a very rich man can't pay him. He says, but you can hold on to my Rolls Royce. And Easy is driving a Rolls Royce. He realizes, you know, very early in the novel, he has to stop doing it because the police stop him, you know, every 10 blocks. He said, we know you don't belong in this Rolls Royce, boy. Now, come on, get out of here.
There's a passage. One thing I never forget was that I was a Black man in America, a country that had built greatness on the bulwarks of slavery and genocide. But even while I was well aware of the United States' crimes and criminals, still I had to admit that our nation offered bright futures for any woman or man with brains, elbow grease, and more than a little luck. Do you believe that? Or is this merely—
Oh, absolutely. No, absolutely. That's something that Easy and I agree on.
Okay.
There's that thing. You sit there and you're standing with a person and there's some other guy, you know, who's born rich and went to Harvard and has millions of dollars and all these other things that you might want. Mm-hmm. And so the person will say to you, hey, you know, man, I wish I was in his shoes. I wish I was him. Like, look what he has. And you turn to him and say, yeah, you know, he has cancer. And the guy said, well, you know, I don't want that. I said, no, you know, if you want to be in his shoes, that's what's standing in his shoes.
I'm assuming that when it came time to write scenes with police, you didn't have to like reach far to figure out how did police treat Black folks back in 1969.
There's a certain limitation. But one of the things I kind of like about Easy, there are police he gets along with.
Yeah.
He knows all kinds of people, and we know all kinds of people. And the minute you start making a prejudicial notion about a person, about a type of person, you know you're going to be making a mistake.
Scan the QR code on your screen with your phone's camera to watch the full interview and find out Walter's secret to being a prolific writer.
As part of their Black History celebration, the St. Louis County Library awarded their annual Frankie Muse Freeman Inspirational Award, which is named in honor of the renowned St. Louis civil rights attorney and recognizes those with significant community service. The 2021 honoree is James Clark, Vice President of Public Safety and Executive Director for the Urban League of Metropolitan St. Louis.
Congratulations, Mr. Clark, and thank you. Your service to the St. Louis area to champion poverty and crime reduction and better services for the disenfranchised speaks to the very spirit of what the Freeman Award embodies. Ms. Freeman's spirit certainly continues on through the extraordinary work you are doing in our community.
Scan the QR code on your screen to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram.
Gary Zagrine is among the first in St. Louis to receive the first generation COVID-19 vaccinations.
I know we've been waiting a while.
Gary has a heart condition, diabetes, and an aneurysm, making him high risk for severe illness, even death, from COVID-19.
It's been so long thinking that you could catch the virus and die. Now that the vaccine's out, it's such a relief.
Eagerness for the mRNA COVID-19 vaccinations is experienced at locations in the St. Louis area, including Mercy Hospital, St. Louis. Yeah. More vaccines are coming, and over time, not all will be the same type. Experts say the next generation of vaccines could be even better. This may include a nasal spray, not an injection. It's delivered in one dose through the nose.
That made it superior to the other vaccines that required multiple doses.
Researchers in this Washington University School of Medicine lab developed a COVID-19 nasal vaccine that's now produced by academic spinoff company Precision Virologics. Professor Dr. David Curiel is the interim CEO. A human clinical trial for the vaccine is now underway. Precision partnered with a vaccine manufacturer in India, where the trial is taking place.
An Indian company named Bharat Biotech licensed our agent. They manufactured it with our help. They got through regulatory in India, and they started phase one intranasal vaccine trial. So if all goes according to plan, by March, we'll have human data with our vaccine.
To develop the vaccine, they used the SARS-CoV-2 spike protein, inserting it inside another virus called an adenovirus.
The adenovirus is a common cold virus. We used a chimpanzee adenovirus. Major advantage of using a non-human adenovirus. It could penetrate preformed immunity.
Curiel says the nasal vaccine is proven safe and effective in animal studies. And a bonus, it does not require ultra-cold storage.
The side effects of adenovirus do appear to be less than with mRNA, which have been soreness, fatigue, fever symptoms. Those symptoms are thought to be linked to the storage agent for the mRNA. It's called polyethylene glycol.
And he says the nasal delivery route creates a more widespread immune response than an injection. It would destroy any coronavirus already present and prevent the spread of the virus to others.
Not only could it induce protective immunity, but it sterilized the upper respiratory tract, which may be important to limiting person-to-person transmission containing the pandemic.
If the clinical trial goes as well as expected in India, Curiel expects a clinical trial in the United States this year.
And we're in discussions with two companies who will manufacture the agent. We have clinicians here at both institutions that are wanting to do the phase one trial with our agent.
You can find the full story on this next generation vaccine on our website, hecmedia.org.
My name is Daryl Pitchford. My nicknames are Big Dog and OG. The guys like to call me that from time to time. Original gangster. That's a term of respect in the hood. I never thought I'd be a baker. Never. It's funny how things happen, you know? I don't know if I would get as much gratification from another career as I do from this one. the feeling of, you know, being able to take a little flour and a little water and a little butter and make something magnificent. I think there's a therapeutic aspect to it. I know how I feel when I'm baking, you know, a certain level of exuberance. I work with a group of young guys. I'm able to help them just to kind of be a role model and just to let them know that you can do it. Amazing, man. 2 months ago, he didn't know none of this.
Yeah, this is the only job I've actually liked.
Now you're a pro. In most cases, they need help. They need guidance. They can benefit from my experience, my life experience. They will listen to me. It's because they know I've been there. I was married in Chicago. In 10, we got divorced. She got the house. My children are here in St. Louis. I talked to my son. He says, oh, don't worry about it, Pop. Come on down here and stay with us. And then he ended up losing his house. And so we had to hit the streets. And that's when my journey began. Here I am, 57 years old, and I'm on the street, you know. And it was quite an experience, say the least, okay? It's quite an experience. So I started breaking in the garage at night. I was standing in somebody's garage, and I almost froze to death in that garage. And so that was the worst. Yeah, that was the worst. I woke up and half my body was frostbitten. Well, that was the first time that I actually got afraid. On the street, I was never afraid. That was the first time I was afraid. I've always been willing to work. How do you get a job if you don't have a mailbox or an address or a bed to sleep in at night? It's kind of difficult. People feel like they're being rejected, and people are being rejected, not just feeling like it. They feel that way because they are being rejected. So yeah, you lose hope, and I think that's what kills you. Because once you lose hope, you can dig a hole and climb in. It's over. I don't feel like it would have happened without Bridge Bread. And not just the job, because the job is one thing, but the support network that you're in when you're with Bridge Bread, that made the difference for me.
Being a Bridge Bread baker, we're willing to kind of understand that there's still some chaos in their lives, so that when there's a stumble, it's not over, you know, and we'll work with them. So the transformational process is, I accept you the way you are. I'm not going to try to find a way to fire you. I'm not going to try to find a way to hurt you. I'm not going to try to take anything away. Instead, I'm going to hold you up when you fall down a little bit, but you're going to have to be putting the energy into it. And when you do, it'll be your success.
They meet you where you are. And I think that makes a lot of difference. You know, if I have a drinking problem, you have to help me address that. If I have a drug problem, then you have to help me address that. And if you don't, you're not really helping me.
They start making bread or cinnamon rolls. And people are dying for them. And you look at the cinnamon rolls, you go, I made that. I can do something good. I can succeed. I can hope again. And that's what we do for them. We give them the ability to hope.
I know it's a wonderful program because it has helped me, and I know others who the program has helped. People have come here and worked for a while and moved on to other things, you know, other jobs, other careers. It's amazing to hear guys talk about 401k programs. You know, a year ago they didn't have a bank account. You know, that's the kind of growth I think you want to see from a program like this. If you can help somebody get to the next phase, whatever that is for them in their life, or the next level, I think that's key. Well, I'm trying to show them that, you know, just find you a little job and work it consistently, be true to it, and you can get your life back in order. You know, and I'm living proof of that. I'm in a good place in my life right now, and I'm happy. Loving life. Living the dream, as they say.
Matco celebrates a special occasion later on Spotlight.
It's like in music, you got different instruments. They got to play a symphony. So even these that we take from nature, they have to play the symphony of this mural.
The mural was first created shortly before Henry Shaw opened the museum and indeed the whole Missouri Botanical Garden to the public. And over the years that deteriorated, bits fell down at various times during its history.
It has to be close to the original because it's a historic recreation. It's an homage of some sort to something that was really beautiful and very well done.
In this case, it's not that easy to be precise because we've got fragments of it. 60% of it was destroyed over the past 150 years from water damage, and it was overpainted several times.
The original, I love it, but we're gonna do better.
Part of the excitement of this restoration of the building is we are able to go back to peel off the layers of paint and do a faithful replica of what had been there in 1859.
What do you feel when you're attached to somebody, attached to a woman? It's a tremendous feeling. It's the same thing. This is my woman. Really.
Scan the QR code on your screen with your phone's camera to watch the full documentary.
The title, Futures President, actually came from Bertrand Piccard, and he was talking about a recent flight he had took to test a solar flight, and he was kind of describing his feeling of coming back from that, and he described the landing as going back to the past, sort of thinking about everything that brought him to that moment and testing that flight and the technologies and kind of looking at what our current technologies are and where technology could take us. So I just thought that was a really interesting way to describe kind of the present, but also looking at the future and what that might look like and sort of using the information we have now, using the technology we have available to us to explore. And so I was thinking about, you know, how are artists doing that same thing, where somebody like the artist Van McElwee is using augmented reality in their work and really testing the possibilities of that and kind of using Laumeier as a platform for that. So what I was really interested in is like how artists kind of play. They're sort of playing and exploring, but they're also talking about and addressing issues around the climate and our environment and our role in that. Another artist in the show that you'll see is Elias Sime. He's an artist based in Ethiopia and he makes work with tech waste, where he'll kind of grab these different parts of old computers, keyboards, wiring, things like that, and he'll sort of weave them and turn them into these kind of 2D landscapes. We've got another artist, Daniel Canagar, who's based between Madrid and Los Angeles, and his work is looking at the different climate accords. So the way that people will view this work is it's split into four cities. and referencing different climate accords that were signed in those cities. And what he's interested in is how text is treated in a way that it's almost meaningless. So he's relating that to the wind and sort of taking text from these climate accords and translating them and using that data and turning them into these kind of visual, kind of moving pieces.
I am an artist and I live in New Orleans, and in my work, I'm thinking a lot about global warming and what it's like to live in this time, the historical legacies that got us there, and then how to collectively imagine a different future. My materials are really rooted in thinking about that history. This drawing is made from a combination of sugarcane, which was the staple chattel slavery crop. This is thinking about how people and environment have been exploited and extracted from over history, and then the paper is combined with shredded plastic. So a lot of former plantations are now petrochemical facilities. So really, with paper making, using water to combine the sugarcane and the plastic into one sort of hybrid material that bridges that history.
We all have a role to play, and even if it's just the smallest thing that we do to kind of change in our, you know, in our everyday sort of individual lives, then I think it would be a success.
On display at Laumeier through May 9th.
With every stroke of the bow, every stroke of the brush, with every stroke of genius, the arts make life in St. Louis richer, not just emotionally, but also economically. In our region, the arts create almost $600 million a year in economic activity, supporting more than 19,000 jobs, generating almost $60 million for state and local governments, with almost 12 million annual arts-related visits. That's more than all St. Louis sporting events combined. Whether in a park, on a street, or a wall, experimental or a classic, the arts deserve our support, because the arts help support us. HEC Media is proud to be our region's home for arts, education, and culture, because in St. Louis, the arts mean business.
Modern America Dance Company has been bringing original productions to the stage for over four decades. To mark a milestone 40th year, they look to Washington University in St. Louis for inspiration.
We are taking our first steps in the research for a performance called Freedom. It's a collaboration with Washington University Olin Libraries, and we're bringing their civil rights special collections to life through dance.
We're looking at pictures and films and trying to figure out where we're going to go with this project.
The Film and Media Archive is the home of the Henry Hampton Collection. And Henry Hampton was an independent African-American filmmaker who's best known for making Eyes on the Prize, and it's become the high watermark for African-American history and the civil rights movement.
Looking through the lens of Henry Hampton is a shocking glimpse of American history.
First of all, I'm having flashbacks because I was born in 1960. So I grew up in Alabama doing a lot of that, and I remember seeing images of that on television.
I think really gives us a more realistic glimpse as to the actual atrocities that were occurring at the time. It really just puts me there.
I was inspired by the pictures of lynching to create the first section because also saw the dancers reacting really strongly about it and emotionally. I'm using the image of the silk, sort of like the lynching. It is haunting us still today.
The one that spoke to me the most was
the demonstrators, they were going across the Pettus Bridge, but they had a flag, I believe, and then there was clouds in the background. That one really spoke to me because it was just the sense of community moving toward something and the whole idea of movement.
I was really struck by the faces and the joyous faces that are the happiness and celebration of another person's murder and death. I really started asking the questions of how does a person get to a place where they think they're so much better to harm another person or even kill another person? And what is that division and separation? And do they feel remorse after that? Were their actions choices, or was it a sort of a product of environment?
I think all of us have experienced a situation where we've been stripped from something and how it affects us emotionally and how we communicate with other people when we see something like that happen. Do we turn the cheek or do we respond graciously?
The science behind how we learn and why learning something new can bring you joy. Plus, St. Louis in watercolor. See the places featured and why they created the book. Thanks for watching Spotlight. Join us next Sunday at 9:30 a.m. on KPLR 11.